City of Romulus City Council Regular Meeting for Monday, September 22nd, 2014. The roll will show that all members are present with the exception of Councilwoman Choate and Councilman Wadsworth.
They are excused.
So noted. Tonight's council agenda, council meeting agenda is as follows. Number one, agenda, 2 minutes, three, petitioner, four, chairperson's report, five, mayor's report, six, a clerk's report, six, treasurer's report, seven, public comment, eight, finished business, nine, new business, 10, communication, 11, warrant, 14-18, and number 12, adjournment. And a motion would be in order to accept the council meeting agenda as presented.
So moved.
Support.
Been motioned by Mr. Kraut, supported by Ms. Makowski, for approval of the agenda as presented. Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Roscoe?
Yes.
Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Agenda approved.
2A, approval of the minutes from the regular council meeting held September 8th, 2014.
So moved to approve the minutes from the regular council meeting of September 8th.
Support.
Motion by Ms. Makowski, supported by Ms. Abdo, for approval of the minutes from the regular council meeting held September 8th, 2014. Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved.
2B, approval of the minutes from the special council meeting held September 8th, 2014 at 7:15 p.m. This was a study session regarding the Wayne County Hazardous Mitigation Plan.
So moved for the special meeting study session for the Wayne County Hazardous Mitigation.
Support.
Motion by Ms. Roscoe, supported by Ms. Abdo, for approval of the minutes from the special council meeting held September 8th, 2014, study session for Wayne County Hazardous Mitigation Plan. Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved.
There are no petitioners on the agenda. Number four is the chairperson's report.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. At 5:45 p.m., we had a study session discussing our fourth quarter audit. And at 6 o'clock, we had a study session in communication site cell tower for the lease agreement amendment. And at this time, I'm going to recognize, the chair recognize council member Abdo.
Yes, I'd like to make a motion to accept the communication site cell tower lease agreement with American Tower. These are the towers that are located at Fire Station 1 and Fire Station 4.
Support.
Motion by Ms. Abdo, supported by Ms. Roscoe for the lease agreement. Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved. At 6:45, we had a public hearing at Oakwood Industrial Park Subdivision Special Assessment District. And at 7 p.m., we had another public hearing on Oakwood Industrial Park Subdivision Special Assessment Roll. And at this time, I would like to, first of all, call up Joe in the audience. He'd like to give us some information.
Yeah, that's
true. Some good information, I hope.
It's good.
All right, Joe.
Joe Ozog, 9403 Berry. Wadsworth couldn't make it today. I think he's out of town. But I got Stacy a check for $1,193 from the bingo.
All right.
Okay. And 2 weeks from now, he'll have the list of his workers.
All right. All right. Okay, great. Thanks a lot, Joe. And again, I'd like to bring up a person that we had a little competition. City versus the Board of Education. And he will let you know who won. I'd like to bring up school board member Tom Kuderick.
Thank you there, Mr. Barton.
Thank you, Tom.
different sitting on this side of the table here.
Right.
The school board offered a challenge to the city council, and we'd like to try to make this an annual thing. We were trying to do a few different ideas of tug-of-war and horseshoes, but Mr. Barton, Phil, he probably would not be able to achieve in the horseshoes, so city council was lacking on the disability claims or something, I don't know. But anyways, we had Jasmine got us hooked up with a beanbag toss called the cornhole thing, so we're going to try to do this every year, and we had three council members, Mr. Kraut, Mrs. Roscoe, and Mr. Barton, competed against myself and Mrs. Kraut. We played three games. It was the best out of three games. The first game, the school board won it. That's good. Played to 21. Second game, city council won it. They got there first. So we had to go to sudden death. Even with our MVP, Sandy Kraut, the city council did achieve, and we will bring the trophy over to you as soon as we get it back. It says city council on it, 2014. So congratulations, and next year we're practicing. We got a training day. Do you have any questions on that? I know we, despite all the rain, nobody backed off. We stayed in the rain, played in the rain and everything. So nobody took shelter. I don't know what Mrs. Kraut puts on her hair, but she had the best hairdo out there.
And Tom, I think that, that's a good suggestion to bring the city and the Board of Education together and make an annual event. And Jasmine, she did a great job. She explained the game to us. That's the first time I played, and I really enjoyed it, even though it was raining outside. It was really enjoyable. I didn't mess up my afro, but I didn't have too much left anyway, half of it. But it was really enjoyable. I'm looking forward in the future to challenge you and win again.
We got a training camp going. We'll send you a video of that later. Thank you, folks.
Okay, thank you, Tom. Okay. Now I'd like to turn it up to the mayor.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, you know, I wanted to wind the clock back a few meetings ago. We had, as all of us know, really, the very unfortunate situation that happened in our community. We had a young man, Armani Gibson, that passed away in an automobile accident. We had a meeting where we had a lot of people that were emotional, to say the least. At that meeting, what I pledged to city council and to the public is that we would make sure that the state police did a thorough investigation of what happened, that we would report, number one, back to the mother and the family, what happened, the facts. We would report to city council what happened with the facts. We would report back to the public and be transparent with what happened. So what I wanted to do tonight, if we could, under your report, Mr. Chairman, is basically have a kind of a summary of what happened, still respecting the family. I can't imagine the loss of a young man. I mean, I have a child that's 19. And so what I would ask is that we allow our Director of Public Safety, John Leacher, to come and share some of the facts from the Michigan State Police finding, just so that we owe it, number one, to the family. We owe it to our city and our department. That was honestly, there were some things that were said, I believe, just out of emotion that night, unfortunately. But my obligation to the people is to make sure that they know that we have good government, we have good departments, we have employees that are doing a good job and to the best of their ability. And in all defense of those people, especially in police and fire, who are out there daily putting their life on the line, I think it's really important that we at least share some of those facts with the public because it was made so public. So, Mr. Chairman, what I'm asking is if you would call on our director to come up and at least go through some of that for the public.
Yes. Mr. Leacher, would you please come up, please?
Thank you, Mr. Barton, Mayor, Madam Clerk, Madam Treasurer. As the mayor alluded to, or it spoke of it just a moment ago, back in July, July 24th to be exact, in the very early morning hours, a tragic incident took place here where we lost the life of one of our young people. There was a lot of speculation and a lot of questions that came as a result of that. As a community, we asked to allow the state police to conduct their investigation and us to conduct ours from the police department standpoint. And as promised, as the mayor promised, and I'm here tonight to do is to let the community, let our community know exactly what happened that evening. First of all, I think it's important that everyone knows that as soon as the results of this investigation were made known to us, as far as the police department goes, they were shared immediately with the immediate family, with Armani's mother. We contacted her. We asked her to bring the people she wanted to come to see to be debriefed on this. So they were debriefed with reports, with video, and with audio, and then given a full opportunity to take advantage of obtaining all of the information, not just the summary information we gave. So there's been nothing that's held back. The only thing missing at this point from the entire investigation is a toxicology report, which is part of the autopsy, which typically takes several months. Neither the state police nor us nor the administration felt that it was necessary to hold up presenting what we had to the family any longer than we had to, so we chose to bring them together to do that. What I would like to do now is just go over basically a synopsis of the investigation and then some concluding comments as well. So on the evening of July 23rd, we had a threats complaint on 4th Street. We sent an officer to take that complaint. In that complaint, which was very thoroughly investigated, there were comments made through texting that the people that perpetrated the threat were going to come back that evening to cause damage to further property damage, as well as threats on the people that lived at that location. That officer works over into the midnight shift hours, and at approximately 1 o'clock in the morning shortly thereafter is going down 4th Street and observes a vehicle across the street from the house that had the threats made against it, lights off, engine running, occupied by one occupant. So the officer does what we would hope he would do and what he's trained to do, which is to investigate to see what's going on. And what I'd like to do is pause here to play you some of the audio to the radio traffic that transpired between the officer and our dispatch. So in summary, the officer has called out the location where he's at, he's called out the vehicle, and dispatcher has asked him, do you want the vehicle information? He says no, and as you could hear in the third transmission, the vehicle is simply outside the location where the threats complaint was made earlier that evening, and he's wanting to investigate what's going on. What the officer then does is he steps out of his vehicle, activates his overhead lights, steps out of his vehicle, he walks up to the vehicle that is occupied. The vehicle is occupied by Mr. Gibson. Upon making contact with Mr. Gibson, he asks him why he's there. He says he is trying to find out where his girlfriend lives. She's in the area, and he's texting her to try to find a location where she lives. During the conversation between the officer and Mr. Gibson, the officer smells marijuana in the vehicle. He asks Mr. Gibson if there's anything in the vehicle that he needs to be aware of. Mr. Gibson says no. Because he's trying to be courteous, and not because he's obligated to, because the simple smell of marijuana in the vehicle at that time gives the officer probable cause to search the vehicle. But he asks Mr. Gibson instead, do you mind if I search the vehicle? Mr. Gibson says, yes, I do. You can't search my vehicle. The officer then attempts to open the door of the vehicle to search the vehicle, asks Mr. Gibson to step out of the vehicle. Mr. Gibson refuses to step out of the vehicle, and as the officer opens the door to bring him out of the vehicle. Mr. Gibson reaches for the for something in the center of the vehicle, reaches towards the center of the vehicle. The brake light goes on on the rear of his vehicle, Mr. Gibson's vehicle, and then he is seen fleeing from the location. The officer then runs back to his vehicle and then attempts to try to catch up to Mr. Gibson, who is probably the better part of a tenth to a quarter of a mile ahead of the officer at that time. The video, which I'll show you shortly, will then show Mr. Gibson's vehicle hitting Beverly Road, coming south from 4th, and going eastbound on Beverly Road from 4th Street. The officer is seen then turning eastbound on Beverly Road as well. And as he turns eastbound on Beverly Road, Mr. Gibson's vehicle is even further in front of the officer's vehicle than it was initially, and you'll see there's quite a distance initially between the two vehicles. As the officer is attempting again to catch up to Mr. Gibson's vehicle, you will see in the video Mr. Gibson's vehicle loses control. It goes off the roadway, slides off the roadway to the left on the screen on the north side of Beverly, and then goes across Beverly Road and then striking a pole. Mr. Gibson is ejected from the vehicle and is subsequently killed upon impact, or killed at the scene. The officer drives up, gets out, calls for emergency response, then runs up to see if Mr. Gibson is all right, and sees, based on catastrophic injuries suffered by Mr. Gibson at the scene, that he is in fact deceased. That is what the video will show you. The state police are then called in to investigate this. The officer secures the scene. The state police come in and they do a very thorough investigation. What their investigation entailed was a thorough check of not just Mr. Gibson's vehicle, but a thorough check of the officer's vehicle as well. The officer's vehicle is actually impounded, and the trooper that investigated the case basically stated to us that when he comes out, he stated this to the family as well, when he comes out to investigate a case, he doesn't see a police car, he just sees cars, and he knows what he needs to do, and he does the same thing, goes through the same process every time. So he impounds the police vehicle and he checks that vehicle, every inch of that vehicle, to see if it made contact with the vehicle, that the other vehicle that was in question. He finds there was no contact made by that officer's vehicle. He then does a complete and thorough check of the vehicle Mr. Gibson was driving, along with other investigators as well, state police investigators. What they find is, upon looking at that vehicle, that the vehicle tires on Mr. Gibson's vehicle are almost completely bald. And in fact, in a picture that I'll show you later, you'll see that on the one tire is, for all intents and purposes, completely bald. There was very, very little, if any, traction on that tire, and all four tires on the vehicle were in similar condition. The thorough investigation of the vehicle also reveals that lodged under the seat of the driver's side seat of the vehicle, Mr. Gibson's vehicle, was a .380 semi-automatic handgun, and marijuana in a glass jar was also recovered from that vehicle. The autopsy report, which again was also provided to the family, showed that Mr. Gibson died from multiple blunt force trauma injuries. He was ejected from the vehicle and killed. The crash data information that was retrieved from the vehicle showed that the vehicle, and I'll show a slide on this as well that will kind of give you a visual, but the vehicle was traveling 5 seconds prior to impact. It was traveling at 89 miles an hour. The gas pedal was basically fully depressed. Mr. Gibson never depressed or never touched the brake pedal, and his seat belt was not engaged. He was not wearing a seatbelt. So at this time, I will show you the video.
Thank you.
So one of the things I forgot to mention, the state police investigator, the accident investigator, noted that there was water on the roadway, and you could see that in the video. The water on the roadway, we believe, they believe, and we do as well, we believe that that was probably from irrigation system on the Gateway Golf Course. But what happened was a combination of the speed, those tires being basically bald, and Mr. Gibson striking that water, basically the accident investigator determined very quickly that there was really no way to recover from that, and that even a very experienced driver would have had a difficult time navigating that, let alone someone with limited driving experience like Mr. Gibson's. So basically, you know, what I'd like to do at this time is just kind of dispel some of those rumors that came about as a result of those first couple of meetings and some of the things that were said and that we had heard, we had all heard within the first week or two after this tragic incident took place. Obviously, you can see from the video that the officer did not bump Mr. Gibson's car. The officer did not shoot Mr. Gibson. The autopsy obviously confirmed that his death was caused by multiple blunt force trauma injuries. The police car, again, as seen in the video, was several hundred feet from Mr. Gibson's car when Mr. Gibson lost control and crashed. The officer acted completely within state law as well as within policy and procedure of the Romulus Police Department. And unfortunately, Mr. Gibson is the one that chose to run from the officer that night, and it was his actions and his actions alone that caused the terrible and tragic outcome that we saw here. What I like to do now is pretty much summarize with some slides the things that I think are kind of the most important things we should take from this as far as what I think this really comes down to is choices and making poor choices and bad decisions. And I can emphasize that here with the slides. You know, as you can see here again, Mr. Gibson chose to run from the officer. He ran from the traffic stop. You can see this is how far he is as the officer, whose elbow you can see right here. He is running back to his vehicle to again attempt to catch up to Mr. Gibson. This just shows when he starts driving how far away from the officer's vehicle Mr. Gibson is. He's traveling at a high rate of speed already. This is the corner of Beverly Road. That's Mr. Gibson's vehicle is right here. He's already turned onto Beverly Road. You can still see how far the officer is back from his vehicle. And this is when the officer makes the turn onto Beverly Road. This is Mr. Gibson's vehicle, which is quite a distance in front of his and continues to gain ground on the officer as the officer is trying to catch up. This slide here again, the water, the bald tires causing the vehicle to, you can see it's going way left of the center line here. And in this next slide, you can see it's difficult to see, but or you can see the water in the road. So the water in the road with the tires, you can see the water right here. And those are the tires. That's one of the rear tires, but all the tires were in similar condition on his vehicle. The vehicle here after is just before the crash. It's the headlight is right here. It's crossed over the road. It's about to hit the culvert and strike the pole. And this is that crash data information that I talked about earlier. And you can see here 5 seconds prior to crash, 89 miles an hour. Vehicle RPM speed, there was no more, the throttle's at 100%, which means there were no more RPMs for that vehicle to give. The brake switch circuit was off, that means he did not use a brake at all, and the accelerator pedal 5 seconds before was at 100%. Obviously, you can see what at zero, this is probably just after he hit the water and he took his foot off the brake or off the gas pedal and was trying to gain control of the vehicle at that point without being able to. And this again shows he was not wearing his seatbelt. This right here comes right off of that crash data information. Driver's belt switch circuit status unbuckled, means the belt was unbuckled at the time of the impact 5 seconds before. And this is a shot right here. This is the seat. This is the where the shoulder strap should be going through. And this is the seat belt buckle in a position where there's no way it would have been buckled in that position. And again, poor choices. Marijuana found in the vehicle. This is the 380 handgun that was found under the seat, was simply pulled up under the seat so they could take a photograph of it, the state police. And this, again, we can see the magazine to the left of the handgun, which is fully loaded. The gun was fully loaded when they found it. And unfortunately, all these things lead up to a tragic, terrible, tragic outcome and the loss of life of one of our young people. So in summary, I'd just like to say that, you know, I've heard a lot of, and I had an opportunity to meet Mr. Gibson, and I don't believe that Mr. Gibson was always displaying this kind of behavior. As a matter of fact, I know he wasn't, because I talked to several people, including school officers and teachers alike, that had nothing but great things to say about him up until about the first 16 years of his life. In fact, he was an honor roll student at one point and should have been about 2 weeks into his first semester at Western Michigan University right now. He had a scholarship. So this, again, comes down to bad decisions and poor choices. So I guess if there's one thing or a couple of things I'd like to leave everyone with tonight, it's that I ask our community, our entire community, to continue to pray for his family, because they've lost someone very dear to them. And I encourage every mother, father, and grandparent to keep talking to their kids about making good decisions, about difficult situations, because some of those decisions, unfortunately, like in Mr. Gibson's case, they can't be undone, and you don't get a second chance.
Mr. Chairman, in closing, I just wanted to add that, you know, the whole intent with this was to fulfill my obligation to you as a counsel, to the family, and to the public, you know, in no way to cast any bad light on what happened or towards the family. And I would reiterate what John said, keep the family in your prayers. It was also very difficult on first responders, you know, that show up on the scene, that are doing their job in law enforcement, and have to deal with the emotional side of seeing a young man, in this case, lose his life. So I just want to make sure we share some facts, and I go back to what John said, choices, and unfortunately, and I appreciate the family and sitting down, and I also want to thank the state police. They don't always come in, and they came here for the mother, and they said that. They came, they wanted the mother to hear what happened. And I really appreciate that, because they did a thorough investigation, but they did it with compassion, and I appreciate that. The last thing I thought would be appropriate, Mr. Chairman, if we could, we just saw a horrible viewing of an accident. Maybe we could just have another quick moment of silence where people could pray on their own for all that were involved in this.
Yes, may we have a moment of silence, please?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Leacher. Thank you, Mayor, Council, audience. That concludes the Chairman's report.
Mr. Chair, if I may, I'd like to move that we accept your report.
It's been motioned by Ms. Murkowski, supported by Ms. Abdo, to accept the chairperson's report. Ms. Murkowski?
Yes.
Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved. Thank you.
Number five is the mayor's report.
Good evening, council, clerk, treasurer, and audience. Brought a quote. I'll try to turn it into some positive things that have gone on in our community in the last week, and it goes as this. Successful people are always looking for opportunities to help others. Unsuccessful people are always asking, what's in it for me? And we've got a lot of great people in our community, a lot of people that are going above and beyond and helped out. This last weekend, I wanted to send out and recognize some thank yous for our pumpkin festival. We had, despite some weather, we had a very, very successful weekend, a very busy weekend. And if I miss anybody, please forgive me, but as always, started off with the Rotary Parade of Lights. We had to change the route a little bit this year, so thank you for everybody who worked with us on that. I think it was very successful. We staged at the high school, came through downtown, and then went through the downtown area. I think what I heard were some of the better attendance numbers as far as viewing that Parade of Lights. It was a great evening to kick it off. We also had a lot of entertainment going on down in the pavilion area, so that was very well attended with a 50-amp fuse that evening. That played into the change in the route. We had tons of activities throughout the whole weekend. The Pumpkin Festival Committee should be applauded, all of them, for all their effort. They volunteer and give of their time. DDA, who sponsors the event, the Downtown Development Authority, that helped with some of the funding to put this on, so it doesn't come out of the general fund, was very much appreciated. A ton of people behind the scenes. We had DPW people. We had police department, fire department. We had the schools were very involved this year, not just with floats, but they had booths set up down at the festival. We had Arts Council, thank you for that. Some of the money that was raised at some of the events there go through the Arts Council to actually give scholarships to students that are graduating from high school and going on to college. So it's not just a fun time to eat, drink, and be merry and buy crafts, but it's a great cause too to help with scholarship funds. So we had some weather related issues, but all in all, there were a ton of good comments that we got. We solicited feedback from the vendors so we can make sure we're doing better and better as we go. But I was very pleased. We tried some things different this year, and I think it was just a beaming success. And thanks to everybody. There were so many people that were involved to make it a success, and we really appreciate it. I think for the we had the car show, which with the construction still worked well. A lot of the compliments were they liked being actually on Goddard Road and asked if they could do that in future. The tractor show, again, went off fine. We had them on the street because some of that area had been disrupted because of the construction. We had I think one of the largest attendance for our church service Sunday morning. Literally, we were pulling chairs from the beer tent area to accommodate more people, which is a good thing in our Sunday morning service. So we had a full crowd there. And like I said, just a great event. It was a proud time to be in Romulus, a lot of good activity, a lot of good press from us. So just thank you to everybody who either visited, did bingo, right, Joe, or whatever those causes may be. A lot of good causes going on. But it was a good time had by all. Another positive that's going on, and I shared with you last month, what we put together that comes from a way to recognize employees is we have what's called a STAR program. When I first came in office, we had our hometown heroes, which are really highlighting people in all areas that go above and beyond. We had a seniority recognition breakfast that council was invited to that we recognized employees that had 20 years, 30 years of service and so forth. The last couple months, we've had a STAR program, which is a way that employees can write up other employees, managers can write up employees, we can have residents write up employees, recognizing people for doing a great job. We brought those people to you last month. What I wanted to do is recognize a couple employees, and actually tonight ask council as well after I read these to approve the resolution so we can get back to these employees for recognize them as our employees of the month for last month. The first one I want to recognize, and I read a little bit about and just tell you a quick story. The first one is Jasmine Dancy. She's taken on numerous important projects and responsibilities in her current role, always exhibiting enthusiasm, hard work, and she's a great finisher of projects, which is important, getting things complete. She's not afraid to work late. She's an outstanding brainstormer with ideas. She's a real ideas person. She's active in the community. She always displays outstanding customer service. And no doubt Jasmine is a true believer in our vision statement. She pretty much uses it. She lives it. It just comes natural with her. If you look at our completed rocks list, which we do every quarter, what you're going to find is that you know, you're going to see her fingerprints on a lot of those, weaved in several different ways. If it be communication, outreach, things that are going on in the community, and that's a reflection of all the effort she puts in many different areas. And she's been a great addition to our team. She's a longtime Ron Mills resident who went on to higher education, came back to our town, came back to our school system. She's come back to our team in a new role, which is kind of taking City Hall out to the people. And I call her, she's a real spark plug. She's just, everything she does and touches, she does it in a positive way. And she's a person that you can't do without on your team to keep good things going. So with that, and also, as she comes up, this thing, again, going above and beyond, this is our second edition of our newsletter that we brought in-house. And this is pretty much Jasmine's hard work. So we brought it in-house as a cost savings, and also are putting out an awesome product that has a ton of information, and we get a lot of compliments. So I would like to ask council to pass a resolution. This would be for the clerical position of Employee Star of the Month for recognizing Jasmine Dancy, please.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Ms. Roscoe.
I'll make that motion to recognize Jasmine for
employee.
It's because I've known her since she was very little. Employee of the month.
It's been motioned by Ms. Roscoe, supported by Ms. Abdo, to recognize Jasmine Dancy for employee of the month. Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved.
Thank you. And I'd just like to ask Jasmine to come up and let's give her a round of applause for all.
Thanks, everybody. I'm happy to be here.
Thank you, Jay. All right.
Thank you, Council. Once we get those resolutions, we'll make sure we get to the employees. The next one, again, good stuff. And I'm asking Council to recognize this employee. This employee is in the labor area category, and this next individual is Chuck Sharrow. He's been instrumental in developing a successful summer part-time seasonal work program. He's trained and mentored our part-time labor staff, and at the same time has beautified our city's parks. His leadership and work ethic and decision-making has allowed the seasonal work program to be a huge part of our short-term success in a quick time frame. He also represents the city very well in our mutual aid kind of cleanup for the floods. You remember I read a letter from the mayor of Southgate a couple weeks ago. He went and represented the city of Romulus there, and didn't just represent us. I mean, he went and really worked his tail off and made Romulus look very good based on his efforts. He recently also represented the city in a multi-agency equipment operator competition, where his team finished second amongst the Romulus groups. And when you think of Chuck, I've watched him over the summer with this young workforce program, the seasonal part-time, really mature and do some good things. You know, and we talk about mentoring, and that's exactly what he did. And mentoring is getting people to lead in the right path for the right reasons, not just because you're over them or you have some authority over them. It's the ability to influence good behavior and good results out of them. And I've seen some of the people that he worked with and mentored really come on strong and do some great things for our community. And I wouldn't be able to be here telling you that we're opening parks and doing all these great things without, number one, our Teamsters allowing us to have that in the contract, but also people like Chuck and their ability to inspire them to want to do more. He gave me a story one time where he had him on a work project. He had to go and do another assignment, and basically, because of his leadership, they continued working hard and came back and had gotten things done as if he was right there with them, you know, giving them that instruction. That's really the telltale of a good leader, is when people know what to do even when they're not there. And so, you know, I just think that he's done an outstanding job. Again, that came from recognition and people wrote him up. So what I'd like to do is ask council if they would to pass a resolution also recognizing him as our labor employee of the month, and have him come up and get some recognition also.
Mr. Chair, if I may?
Yes, ma'am.
I would be pleased and honored to make the motion that we recognize Chuck Sharrow as employee of the month for the labor group.
It's been motioned by Ms. Makowski, supported by Mr. Kraut, to recognize Chuck Sharrow. for Labor Employee of the Month. Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved.
Thank you very much, Council. I would like to also welcome up Chuck and give him a round of applause for all his hard work.
Being said, I did get it. I inherited a great group of kids. They've busted tail for me all summer long. Went up and beyond. I want to put them on the board. Derek Davis, Travis Laporte, Levi Eddings, Carl Roscoe, these and William Toner. Those kids, they deserve a lot of it. They really have done well with this whole system. I just put them in place to do it, and they've took off. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Chuck.
Thank you, Chuck. And also, they'll also have their photographs put out into the lobby area as well. But we're trying to recognize good behavior, people that are going above and beyond, and those are just a couple examples of it. We have a ton of great employees, you know, and to single out a couple, I know some people may, you know, look at that differently, but I think it's really important to reward and recognize good behavior. But we have a ton of great people, and I'm looking forward to all the great people with months to come that will be recognized that are stepping above and beyond. So thank you for that, Council. A couple other things I did want to cover. Positives. We had talked and rolled out before the Merriman Park, which is going to be our people/dog park. I'm happy to announce that we did get an additional $35,000 from Wayne County Parks to go towards that. We previously had pledged $15,000, recently received a memo from Commissioner McNamara, and starting in October we will be getting an additional $35,000. So that's $50,000 that came from Wayne County for parks to help pay for that. Again, we're trying to do all these things creatively with no new taxes, so I want to give a shout out and thank Wayne County where it's due. You know, some other things that I'd like to just pass on some information, and you know, I've got a lot of phone calls and inquiries even through the Pumpkin Fest about the marketplace downtown and what's going on with the marketplace. Right now, unless Tim has any new information, you know, I was notified that the marketplace did close. There's still some product in. Haven't been able to confirm if anybody really is taking it over yet or not. There's different processes. Do you want to talk on that, Tim, or no? It's up to you. It doesn't matter. Okay. Really, basically, here's what I'd like people to know are two things. Number one, we love our seniors, and we're concerned about them. So what Rose is already doing at the senior center is basically twice a week, Mondays and Thursdays, we're running seniors to get groceries. So if seniors need food, we're going to get them food. We're going to make sure they get bread, milk, eggs. We have transportation so they can get to doctors and get medicines and things like that. So I guarantee you this administration's not going to turn its back on the seniors. So we're working hard in the interim. The second piece of that is we're trying to work on some things downtown. Government has a role. We can do certain things, but we can't run a business for somebody, okay? We can't do that. We can give direction and support and do things in a certain way, but businesses do have to stand on their own, and they have to provide a value proposition that people want to go and visit their businesses. So we're working hard on trying to do some other things downtown. Obviously, we do have road construction going on, but it's going very well. In my opinion, the road construction it really didn't play into this particular situation, but the good thing is we are getting the road fixed, at least the eastern section of it, and in downtown will actually be worked on next spring. So anyway, just wanted to put that out there and let you know what we do know. I don't know anything beyond that at this point, other than we'll try to continue to work and support our downtown area. I do need to also ask for a couple, unfortunately, memorial resolutions. And the first one I'd like to ask Council for, which the service was last week, but will be for the family of Joanne Whaley, if I could.
I'll make that motion.
I'll support that.
Been motioned by Ms. Abdo, supported by Ms. Makowski, for memorial resolution for Joanne Whaley.
Just under discussion, if I could, Mr. Chairman.
Sure.
She was a lifetime resident here. It was actually kind of ironic that when I was at the Crane's funeral home, she was on the Pumpkin Fest committee. She was like a vice chair of the Pumpkin Fest committee. So we were kind of jokingly saying she had a parade for her last day when she was at Crane's. She loved the city. She was involved. She went to school here. She lived here. She loved her community. She went to church here. Her last few months were tough. A lot of people have talked about this ALS and this ice bucket challenge and things that were going on. That's what she was battling with, ALS. So I guess all those people that went and did the ice bucket challenge for whatever reason, and hopefully you made your donations, it's really frustrating with a great person in the community has a disease where there's no cure. So that's why they're working hard to raise funds for that. But her family is hurting, and I would just ask continued prayers and support for her. She was buried at Romulus Cemetery on Saturday.
Okay. Okay. Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved.
Thank you, Council. Next one is for Gladys Betty Wands. Is memorial resolution. That is Jill Lambert's grandmother. She's actually going to be at Crane's tomorrow from 1 to 8, and then there's a service the next day at 4 p.m. at Crane's. Again, this is an employee's grandmother, a great lady. I know she was in her 90s, but still, please keep her family in your thoughts and prayers. Tough to lose loved ones.
Mr. Chair, if I may, approve a memorial resolution for Mrs. Wands.
Support.
Motion by Ms. Makowski, supported by Mr. Kraut, for a memorial resolution for Mrs. Wands. Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved.
Thank you, Council. A couple other things just as far as information that I wanted to bring up that are going on in the community this week. The Ministerial Alliance is having a chili and cornbread cook-off. It's this Friday at the high school, 5 p.m. It's an all-you-can-eat chili and cornbread event. They are $5 tickets at the door, or you can buy them ahead of time. The Romulus Ministerial Alliance is trying to bring all the churches together. Actually, there's an opportunity for churches to win the competition, to win up to $500 for their home church. For winning prizes. So it's not just a fun event to bring churches together. It's open to all, if you belong to a church or not. It's going to be at the high school and in the cafeteria. Again, if you want to cook chili and enter it, be there at 4:30. If you just want to partake in the food, be there at 5. But that's coming up this Friday evening at the high school. Also Saturday, we're coming into the cooler seasons, and there are a lot of people that are in need of food that can't afford a $5 chili cornbread event. There is going to be a food giveaway at Community United Methodist Church this Saturday, and that's going to be starting at 10 a.m. in the morning until the food is gone. There's no real pre-screening or qualifications. It's the honor system. If you're in need and you need food, please be there at Olive and Bibbins, and that'll be this Saturday morning, and they're trying to help people out with food. So those are some informational items that I wanted to pass on. I do have a couple action items for you tonight, if I could, for business tonight under my report. The first one up is 5A, and what I'm asking for is to concur with the administration, authorize the mayor and clerk to enter into a 36-month contract for analog telephone lines for the city of Romulus under the MDO purchasing agreement with the state of Michigan bid with AT&T.
Mr. Chair.
Ms. Roscoe.
I'll make that motion to concur with the administration and authorize the mayor and clerk to enter into a 36-month contract for analog telephone lines for the city of Romulus under the MDO purchasing agreement, state of Michigan bid with AT&T.
Support.
Motion by Ms. Roscoe, supported by Ms. Abdo, to concur with the administration, authorize the mayor and clerk to enter into a 36-month contract analog telephone lines for the city of Romulus under the MDO purchasing agreement, state of Michigan bid with AT&T. Any discussion?
Mr. Chair, if I may,
yes.
Just one comment so the citizens know that this is an 80% decrease from the existing phone line charges.
Thank you. Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved.
Thank you, Council. Next and last item is 5B, and what you have before you is a request to authorize the mayor and clerk to enter into an agreement with Michigan Department of Transportation accepting maintenance jurisdiction for the storm sewer for I-275 Metro Trail along North Line Road.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Ms. Roscoe.
I'll make that motion to authorize the mayor and clerk to enter into agreement with MDOT accepting maintenance jurisdiction of the storm sewer for the I-275 Metro Trail along North Line Road.
Support.
Motion by Ms. Roscoe, supported by Mr. Kraut, to authorize the mayor and clerk to enter into an agreement with MDOT accepting maintenance jurisdiction of the storm sewer for the I-275 Metro Trail along North Line Road. Any discussion?
Yes.
Yes, Ms. Abdo.
Yes. Excuse me. I'm directing this to the Director of Public Works. I'm probably I can't pronounce
Roberto
it.
Roberto Scappaticci.
Roberto. Okay. I realize you're in discussion with Michigan Department of Transportation. This is not really, it's somewhat related, but since you are in discussion with the Michigan Department of Transportation, it's been brought to my attention from other people. They'd like to know what is the condition or what is the status of the repairs to the bike trail along 275.
You know, I would have to look into that. I'm not entirely sure what the status is of the bike path.
Okay, because it is, you know, I see the flooding there. It's a mess.
Right.
They fixed all the way up to Romulus and stopped. So from Romulus south has not been touched, yet they've repaired bridges. Is that something you could find out for?
I will. My understanding is with this agreement that we have right here, they're beginning the construction right at North Line Road to continue further on south. But
would
I can find out those limits, and I can see exactly the scope of the entire project. This contract just deals with our little portion in our city, but I can see what the overall scope is for south of our city.
Okay, can you could report back? Yeah,
absolutely.
And this project's really going to start in the spring of 15.
Yes, this is.
I would really appreciate it because the other part's been completed, what, a year and a half now?
Right, correct.
We would assume they would have picked up our half.
Yep.
Okay, thank you. If you'll get back with us.
Not a problem.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, if I may, I've actually got a question about this topic.
Okay.
Do we, Mr. Scappaticci, how much do we estimate the maintenance charges would be? I mean, is this a typical thing that they do the project and they give us responsibility?
It is typical with MDOT. They don't have a maintenance division with equipment, you know, jet trucks and the equipment that the city has. Typically what they do is a partnership with a jurisdiction like the county or a city when there's an event like this. Most of the contractual work for the highways is actually through the county. They have the equipment, the backhoes, the trucks, the jet trucks. With this particular portion of the project, since there is a little bit of maintenance with storm sewer, their partnership is with us.
Okay.
So it is typical.
Okay,
yes.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you.
Okay. Roll call. Ms. Roscoe.
Yes.
Mr. Kraut.
Yes.
Ms. Makowski.
Yes.
Ms. Abdo.
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved.
Thank you, Council. That concludes my report.
6A is the clerk's report. Under 6A1, we have a request from our city assessor, Julie Albert, for two resolutions to be adopted regarding the Oakwood Industrial Subdivision Special Assessment District in accordance with sections 50-4 and 50-6 of the City of Romulus Code of Ordinances. And there were two public hearings earlier this evening, one at 6:45 and one at 7 o'clock, which has already been stated under the chairperson's report. But the first resolution we're asking council to adopt would be in accordance with section 50-4 of the City of Romulus Code of Ordinances. And this is to authorize the city assessor to proceed with the creation of a special assessment district for the water pump station project for the Oakwood Industrial Subdivision.
So moved to create that special assessment district for the water pump station project.
Support.
Motion by Ms. Makowski, supported by Ms. Roscoe for the Special Assessment District 50-4. Ms. Makowski.
Just one point of discussion. I have a question, and that is if from the study session, the team indicated that they would review, it would be for a period of 10 years, and then they would review after 10 years, the price to see if that was enough or too much. I would just request that after 5 years, you do an assessment of whether, you know, we're overcharging or, you know, because the expenses are less than we projected. And that's all I needed to ask.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Makowski. Roll call, Ms. Makowski.
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe.
Yes.
Mr. Kraut.
Yes.
Ms. Abdo.
Yes.
Chair votes yes, motion approved.
Also under 5A1, for the second resolution, this is in accordance with Section 50-6 of the City of Romulus Code of Ordinance. And this is to confirm and certify the proposed special assessment role for the Oakwood Industrial Park subdivision.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Ms. Abdo.
I'll make that motion to confirm and certify the proposed special assessment role for the Oakwood Industrial Park subdivision.
Support.
And motion by Ms. Abdo, supported by Ms. Makowski for the assessment role 50-6. Ms. Abdo.
Yes.
Ms. Makowski.
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe.
Yes.
Mr. Kraut.
Yes.
Chair votes yes, motion approved.
Under item 6A2, this is a one-hour study session request. This is from our finance director, Suzanne Marino, and also from the director of information technology, Stephen Dudek. This is to discuss the citywide information technology and the BSNA financial management system. This study session is being requested for October 6th, 2014 at 6:30 p.m.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Ms. Roscoe.
So move for study session for October 6th. And what time did you say we were going to have
6:30.
That?
6:30.
6:30.
Motion by Ms. Roscoe, supported by Ms. Abdo, for our study session on October the 6th, 2014 at 6:30. Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. We will have a study session.
6A3, abandonment and discontinuance of portions of road right-of-way within Detroit Metropolitan Wayne County Airport. The Property Disposition Committee met on September 10th, 2014, and is respectfully requesting that council concur with the following recommendation. There are three sections here which can all go into, you know, with one resolution. And this is to authorize the mayor to sign on behalf of the City of Romulus three requests from the Wayne County Department of Public Services indicating that the City of Romulus has no objections to any abandonment if an easement is retained for public utilities. They are, number one, abandonment and discontinuance of portions of the following unimproved road right-of-way situated within the boundaries of the Detroit Metropolitan Wayne County Airport, said boundaries being west of Middle Belt Road, south of Goddard Extension, and Wick Road, east of Vining and Wayne Roads, and north of Eureka Road. The second request, abandonment and discontinuance of a portion of Goddard Extension Road right-of-way, commonly known as West Service Drive, lying south of Goddard Extension, situated within the boundaries of the Detroit Metropolitan Wayne County Airport. Said boundaries being west of Middle Belt Road, south of Goddard Extension, and Wick Road, east of Vining and Wayne Roads, and north of Eureka Road. The third request, abandonment and discontinuance of a portion of William G. Rogel Drive Road right-of-way, south of Goddard Extension, and situated within the boundaries of the Detroit Metropolitan Wayne County Airport. Said boundaries being west of Middle Belt Road, south of Goddard Extension, and Wick Road, east of Vining and Wayne Roads, and north of Eureka Roads. And again, all three requests can be satisfied with one resolution.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chair, if I may?
Yes, Ms. Makowski.
So moved that we approve the abandonment and discontinuance of the three proposals as described by our clerk.
Support.
Been motion by Ms. Makowski, supported by Ms. Roscoe, for approval of the adornment and discontinuance of proportions of the right-of-way. Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved.
6A4, introduction and first reading of amended cost recovery for emergency services ordinance, Chapter 22, Part 2, Article 8, Fire Prevention and Protection.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Ms. Abdo.
I'll make the motion to accept the amended cost recovery for emergency services ordinance, Chapter 22, Part 2, Article 8, Fire Protection and Prevention.
Support.
Motion by Ms. Abdo, supported by Mr. Kraut, for introduction of amended cost recovery for emergency services ordinance, Chapter 22, Part 2, Article 8, Fire Prevention and Protection. Any discussion? Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved.
6A5, request council resolution to correct the minutes of August 25, 2014, resolution number 14-341. What happened here, the bid number in resolution 14-341, it reads 1112-07. And what they're asking, it was a typo, and they're asking council for the correction, which it has been corrected, but we would like the minutes to read the correct bid number, which should be 1011-07.
Okay.
So moved to correct the minutes as described by Madam Clerk.
Support.
Motion by Ms. Makowski, supported by Ms. Roscoe, for the resolution to correct the minutes of August the 25th, resolution number 14-341. Roll call. Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved.
6A6, request council's approval to extend the lease between the City of Romulus and the Downtown Development Authority to store city records at 11189 Shook Road through June 30th, 2016.
If I may, yes. I move that we extend the lease between the City of Romulus and the DDA to store the city records, and just make mention that the charges remain the same as the last contract.
The support on that?
Support.
Motion by Ms. Makowski, supported by Mr. Kraut, for the request for City Council approval of the extended lease between the City of Romulus and the Downtown Development Authority to store city records. Any discussion?
Yes.
Yeah, Ms. Abdo.
I just wonder, don't we have any city property that we can be storing these records on where we're not paying $500 a month? Am I sounding stupid? I just find it hard to believe that we don't have some place here to store.
No, we talked to the clerk about other options here, but at this time,
right now,
they're pretty much clerk records. You have to keep a lot of those records.
Right, we have to maintain, you know, there was that old building, the house that was demolished, and all of those records, they restored much of what they could, and some of those records are stored in the lower level, and that room is filled to capacity, and so the other alternative, because there aren't any other storage places where we can
currently. What about the fire stations we're not using?
Which fire station?
The one on North Line.
I don't know, that's something we can look into. I'd have to get with the administration. I'm not certain.
And it seems like a perfectly good building that's not being used at all, and it's, we already have it, so why would we?
Well, they're actually using it for fire equipment. There's storage that's going on there. I mean, we looked at it before. We actually talked about possibly here and areas in the basement, and we can look at it again, but we did exhaust resources on areas that we could store records in current buildings, and the other fire stations are being utilized for either the ambulance company or our own equipment. So
what's being stored in one? And is equipment being stored?
There's equipment.
And there's no room at all for any other type of storage?
No. And there's also need to be a proper, you know, we need some of the records that the clerk has to keep.
The ventilation and things.
You have to keep,
right.
You have to keep them for a certain period of time, and they need to be locked up and secured so that some of it's employee information, past things that we can't just put in boxes and stack in buildings. So at this time, we did look at all other options. We thought about possibly here, but when I talked to the clerk about it, we felt that we'd be best right now to leave it there.
And to, if I may, through the chair, Councilwoman Abdo, this was, you know, built something I inherited, you know, is coming in. And so we have been trying to look at other options. We tried, you know, even working with the previous administration, working with this administration, really trying to look at other options that we could use, you know, to store our records. And it's kind of an ongoing, you know, project. But again, as the mayor stated, there's, you know, the certain ventilation and temperatures. The records were in pretty bad shape that they were able to salvage. And so again, you know, we're talking about employee records, bank statements, financial records, and election records. And right now that's the, you know, I guess the most viable building that we can use where we can, you know, secure those records. But it is something that, you know, we are, you know, constantly looking at moving forward.
For a permanent solution then?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay.
Okay.
Ms. McCowsky.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Any other question?
Nope.
Okay. Any discussion? Roll call. Ms. McCowsky.
Yes.
Mr. Kraut.
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe.
Yes.
Ms. Abdo.
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Motion approved.
Before I close out my report, I just would like to remind everyone that October 6th is last day to register to vote if you would like to participate in the November 4th general election. And so we, you know, there are online services. You can log on to the state website. We have information on our city's website too for voter registration. Also, absent voter ballots are in. They will actually be mailed out Monday, September the 29th. Also, for those that would like to come in that are that qualify to vote an absentee ballot, beginning Monday, September the 29th, you can come in and vote your absentee ballot as well.
Thank you.
That concludes the clerk's report. And 6B is the treasurer's report.
Good evening, council, mayor, clerk, deputy, and audience. I'd like to remind everybody that tax day is coming up. The 2014 summer taxes are due Tuesday, September 30th. If you have any questions, you can always call our office. Also, today I presented the fourth quarter report, and that consists of an Excel spreadsheet as well as some graphs. And there's some information that that I need to share with council and with you as well. So I just want to read some a paragraph out of the investment report so you know what needs to be covered in that report. The treasurer shall provide Romulus City Council and the Finance Department quarterly investment reports, which provide a clear picture of the status of the current investment portfolio. Schedules in the quarterly report should include the following: a listing of individual securities held at the end of the reporting period by authorized investment category, average life and final maturity of all investments listed, coupon discount or earnings rate, par value and market value, and finally, percentage of the portfolio represented by each investment category. My report did include all those things, and they are available for viewing. And then finally, I'd like to share that accrued interest earned during this period was approximately $43,000. Thank you.
Number 7 is public comment, and this is a portion of our meeting where those in the audience can address council at this time. If you would like to address council, raise your hand. After you've been acknowledged by our chairperson, after he acknowledges you, approach the podium. We ask that you state your name and your address, and that you would please limit your comments to 3 minutes. We do not have any written requests, Mr. Chair, at this time.
Thank you. Is there any public comments in the audience?
Thank you. I never stayed long enough for this part of the meeting to know your protocol. Steve Schwartz, 31600 West 13 Mile, Farmington Hills. I served the city for 10 years as your labor counsel, and I just came to thank you for that opportunity. I can't say it was fun because we went through most of the 10 years were excruciatingly difficult financial situations, And we worked with you and with your staff to work through some very, very difficult times, and we got through them. I'm proud that together we were able to avoid going into receivership and having an emergency manager like, fortunately, several of your neighboring communities have unfortunately been in that situation. During that 10-year period, Romulus was a key part of my practice. I got to work with some great people. Work was very, very interesting and challenging. Together, we had a lot of solutions. So again, I just want to thank you for that opportunity to serve you.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you. Okay. Are there any other comments? Yes, please. Yeah, Ms. Speaker, it's directional. Kind of speaking a little down. Thank you. Okay.
I was wondering, like, will the DPW be assisting clearing out the trees in the creek, like, to assist the flow of the water? Because the last time it was flowed out was about 5 years ago, and the mosquitoes are really bad. So will they be doing it now or the next season coming up?
Mr. Mayor?
You know, I don't know which creek. Now, there are county drains that run through our community, several of them, and actually it's the county's responsibility to do clean-out projects with that. We've been in communication with the county, Mr. Chairman, on some other requests from residents, and I'd like to get more specifics as to where she sees that. We did communicate with the county concerns about the same thing, mosquitoes, blockage, and they can kind of give me an indication as to if there's a plan or maintenance plan in place. I can't tell you I'm real happy with the county's plan for cleaning of the drains. They really don't have a ongoing program. It's usually by request or by special assessment. But if I'll make sure we get her information and know, is it a county drain? I'm not aware of any other creeks that it would be, but if we can get that information, I do have a contact person that I've been trying to go back and forth to with the county to try to get support for residents on that, because it is a reality. They do grow up over time, and if there are blockages, they retain more water, and therefore you do get more bugs and mosquitoes. So maybe what I could do is see our staff here. We'll get the information and find out if it is a county drain or if it's truly a creek. Okay?
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Any other comments? Yes, Ms. Trapp.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Margaret LeDuc. I live at 15486 Anthony. I guess I should start off and say thank you for Brandt, even though it is a chore to get in and out, but thank you. What I'm up here for is to inform the public and you folks that the City Charter Commission is winding down. We have 2 to 3 more chapters. We anticipate going through those next time, which is October meeting. It's the third Wednesday at 6 o'clock. We invite everybody to come. If they have any questions about the charter or anything that's involved, they are free to come. They've always been open meetings, and we've had two people that have come as audience. We are winding down. We do still have recommendations. We do have recommendations for future possible to be on ballots, but at this time we only have 2 that are going to be on the November ballot, and as I had indicated earlier, we do not want to ever have a special vote for anything that we would recommend, because we do not want to extend the city in any way. So I was asked to come and to invite people, because like I said, we are in the wind down stages. We are willing to do anything that the mayor or the council feels that we should do after this time period, but we anticipate at the end of October's meeting that we have thoroughly looked at the charter and come back with recommendations. We've had only, but I say only because that's the only we've had. We've had only suggestions from our departments of what they found wasn't workable, and we've gone through and looked at them and discussed them not only as a committee, but with the city attorney and with other other departments and gone through it. But at this time, I thought I would give a report to you and invite the public to come to our meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other more comments from the audience? Okay, we'll close that part out.
Number 8 is unfinished business. Number 9, new business. Number 10, communication.
If I may, through
yes,
the chair.
Ms. Murkowski.
When Mayor Burkroff was talking about what a great time it was at the Pumpkin Festival, it reminded me that during the revelry, the Parade of Lights, someone lost some glasses in the parking lot at the Progressive Hall. I picked them up. They're in great shape still. And our treasurer has agreed to let me put them at the counter. So if anyone's lost their glasses, please come there to the treasurer's counter and collect them.
Mr. Chair, if I can, through communication, just would like to remind everyone that this week is the citywide yard sale, which will begin Thursday, September 29th, and will end Sunday, September the 28th. And the list will be posted, will be on our website as well as Facebook. There's still time to get your name on the list. Also, we'll have hard copies at the clerk's office. This is a good time, and so we would, you know, just want to remind everyone that that is going on this weekend. Keep our fingers crossed that our weather will hold out.
All right.
Also.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
You're welcome.
Well, actually, Celeste first, and then I've got another.
Okay.
I got a couple.
Yes, Ms. Roscoe.
First of all, this Friday, there's a fish fry from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., and it will help fund the 50th family reunion for the Bardens, Hamiltons, Summers, and Rozier's family. It's at 5507 Henry Ruff in Westland, and it's, again, I said it's a fish fry, so there's a couple different kinds of fish, and the... $10 a meal, and there's delivery is available. You can contact Stephanie at 734-740-2468 or Mark at 734-624-7054 or Wanda at 734-718-1445. And if you have 10 orders or more, they will deliver that for you. So come on out and help support their family reunion, and it's again, it's their 50th family reunion. I think that's pretty great that you have that every single year.
Okay.
I just would like to say I think the Pumpkin Festival went great, even though we had some rain and got wet. I want to thank everyone who came out and had pancakes. The Boy Scout Troop 872 and their Cub Scout Pack 872 really appreciates the help and the donations for that, and I would just like to say that we've reactivated the Cub Scout troop. And if you have little ones that are interested in elementary school that are interested in Cub Scouts, 872 meets on Monday nights. So you can get a hold of Wayne Langenis, and he can help you get your cubby signed up.
Thank you, Ms. Roscoe. I have one. Go ahead, Ms.
Okay, thank you kindly. So this is the last time that I can announce that the class of 1974, Romulus High School, is having their class reunion this Saturday at the Progressive Hall. Doors are open at 6, dinner's at 7. $50 a ticket. Please contact Sue Ruffalo-Evitz at 734-444-7765. We're going to have a great time.
Okay, thank you. I have another announcement. Identical.
Yes.
This is for the Romulus High School class of 1974. Again, 40th class reunion this Saturday, 27th, at the Romulus Progressive Hall. For tickets and information, contact Mark Lukowicz It's area code 734-941-0411. And my other communications, I want everybody to cherish the moment. The Lions are in first place. And we beat the Green Bay Packers. And I think we have some good things coming in the future. So thank you for that.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Could I add one communication? I've been getting contacted. We put into place after the last storm the chipping service, and we are still chipping. So I want residents to know. I was through the community today touring it. Roberto and I were out. You know, there's a lot of area to cover. We are still getting to residents. If you want to make sure that you're on that list and you want to either call DPW or my office, we enter them in the City Works, our software, we track them. I did a follow-up today before I could even get Roberto out there. They were picked up. So, but there are still areas that we have branches, so bring them to the road. You know, I think some people are using it as an opportunity to do a little pruning, but we have lots of branches along the side of the road, and we will get to those. Our chipper did go down. We made arrangements to get another chipper while that one's being repaired. So our crews are working hard. They had the festival going on. Our DPW worked really hard on that. So be patient. We're going to get to you. We will get in the next couple weeks whatever it takes to get those cleaned up. So just wanted to remind people we didn't forget. If you want to make sure you're on the list, let us know, and we will document it and make sure it happens. But we're still working hard to clean up the city from that awful storm. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mayor. Ms. Roscoe?
One last thing today. First of all, I want to say kudos to Ms. Lemon for all her hard work with the Cemetery Commission. But, you know, you've worked really hard to and emphasize the fact that the fence needed to be fixed. And, you know, I got to say I was a pessimist. I didn't really think it made that much big of a difference as far as how it was going to look or whatever. But when you drive around the cemetery, it has made 100% difference on how the perception when you come around that corner and everything with extending the fence out for the vacant property that is there for the cemetery. And also it's going to help us be able to utilize it more now. But I just want to thank Ms. Lemon for, you know, pushing your dedication and having a vision and seeing it through. So, but it does look good.
Thank you, Ms. Roscoe.
Okay. There's no more communication. Number 11 for approval is warrant 14-18.
So
Mr.
moved.
Chair?
Go ahead.
Roscoe?
I would like to make a motion to approve the warrant as I read it. First general operating fund is $82,731.35. Major street fund is $11,539.40. Local street fund, $6,958.31. Cable, $573.33. Merriman Road assessment, $7,247.53. Sanitation fund, $242. 911, $19,631.81. Narcotics Enforcement Fund, $1,657.99. Senior Citizen Construction Fund, $391,930. Water and Sewer, $506,399.66. Motor Vehicle Fund, $42,471.18. Technology Services, $778.25. Retirees Insurance Benefits, $1,519.29. And Payroll Fund, $106,313.20, for a total of $1,179,993.30.
Support.
Been motion by Ms. Roscoe, supported by Ms. Mikowski. for pay warrant number 14-18 for $1,179,993.30. Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Warrant number 14-18 will be paid.
Number 12 is adjournment.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Ms. Makowski, supported by Mr. Kraut for adjournment. Ms. Makowski?
Yes.
Mr. Kraut?
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe?
Yes.
Ms. Abdo?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. We are adjourned, and thank you.